Hey, Cassidy, welcome home. My name is Stephen Mitchell, and it is a joy to be here with you. I'm so glad you're joining us. If you're new here, I'm really excited that you have chosen to take a part of your time and spend it with us. Here at Cassidy, we recognize that we're not perfect, but we know the one who is, and that's Jesus, and we all want to be a little bit more like Jesus each and every day. And our hope is that you will join us on that journey, that together we can journey toward being more like Jesus, that we can fall deeply in love with Jesus Christ and deeply in love with this world that he has created so that we can make a difference in this world on behalf of the King of Kings. And so we're excited that you're with us. We're excited that you have decided to hang out with us, and we're excited for this continuing this sermon series. We've been talking about Jesus said what? Taking a look at some of the hard teachings of Jesus, some of the things that make you pause when you hear that Jesus said that, some of the things that make you maybe want to take a step back so that we can understand a little bit more about what Jesus is saying, a little bit more about who Jesus is and what we are called to do as followers of Jesus Christ. We're gonna continue our conversation today by talking about one of the difficult things that Jesus said is that we need to be perfect. And when we think about perfection, it can be something that we look at and we're like, man, there is no way I'm going to attain perfection. I remember when I was in high school, I was on the swim team. I was a freshman in high school, so I was 14, 15. And there was this guy that was on the swim team. His name was Chad. We all called him The Chad because, you know, your name is cooler if you have the in front of it. So it was The Chad. And Chad was about 6 foot tall, and I was 14 years old, and I was not. Chad had blonde hair, blue eyes, and was muscular. And the ladies liked Chad, and all of those things were things that I did not possess. He also had a 1969 Camaro Z28 Rally Sport. The Camaro had all the bells and whistles. It was restored in perfect shape, and this was only 1984, so it's not that distant from 1969. Now those things are super expensive, but he had restored that thing to a immaculate looking ride, and his girlfriend was extremely attractive. All of those things led me to believe that Chad was pretty near perfect. He was also the captain of the swim team and was going to state for backstroke. He had one of the fastest backstrokes in the nation. And he also, on top of all of that, had already signed and agreed and been recruited by, signed and agreed to go to a major college. Everything that I thought I wanted, that guy had. Now, he wasn't all that nice to us, the freshmen. It's not like he was like, oh, you should come hang out with me as a senior. No, but at a distance, we watched him, and we were like, man, that guy's got it all. That guy knows how to do it. He is as close to perfect as I could at 14 have imagined that somebody could be. Like, and this was, oddly enough, back before there was social media. Now the world is filled with a lot of people that people turn to, and they see they see people that appear to be perfect. They appear so much better than you or your existence has ever revealed someone to be. I mean, they're prettier, they're richer, they have more stuff, they have the right stuff, they know what they're doing, and it looks like they have all of their stuff together. Social media, which I just letting you know, it's telling stories, but social media is one of those things that kind of paints that picture. You know, you see celebrities, you see these folks that are doing all the things that you think are the perfect things, and together we get this idea of a concept of others being perfect. And our problem truly is this, that many of us believe perfection is possible, but only for others. It's not possible for me to be perfect. It's not possible for me to be the way that I really want to be. I keep failing. I keep falling. I keep being broken, and I can't make it to where I want to go. And that makes it hard when we hear Jesus say things and call us to perfection. Actually, Jesus says it this way: be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Be perfect as God is perfect. And now, I don't know about you, last week we talked a little bit about how imperfect I am, and if you missed that and you want to go check it out, it's on our YouTube page. I encourage you to do that. But the point that I'm making is sometimes we hear these things and it causes us to pause, it causes us to stop, it causes us maybe to ignore what we're being called to because it seems like it's impossible. It seems like it's something that God is asking that is beyond our ability. So maybe, you know, maybe he really didn't mean it the way that I think he did. I'm just going to ignore it. I'm just going to move on. And quite honestly, this comes in a section of the Bible where Jesus is saying some really hard things. Last week, we talked about turn the other cheek. That comes right before the section that we're going to talk about today. And so we're going to dive into it. And this is what Jesus tells us in Matthew's gospel. You have heard it said. Now, again, Jesus is using that this is the way it was. This is the way it should be if you are a follower of mine. You have heard it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He, God, causes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? Now, I love that line because this is the gospel that Matthew wrote, and Matthew was a tax collector. And so when Jesus says that, he's talking, you know, talking Matthew's language. So are not even the tax collectors loving those who love them and living in that way? And so Jesus wants us to go a little bit further. He says, and if you greet only your own people, what are you doing that more than others? How are you being better than others? Even the pagans do that. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus said what? I mean, I don't know about you, but when you hear that out of context, when you hear what Jesus is saying, it can make you just be like, I mean, come on, man. There is no way that you're going to be able to convince me that I'm going to be able to be perfect. It's just so difficult. Like I said, we talked last week about my brokenness, how I struggle with some things, and we all struggle with things. So what does it mean to do that? Because Jesus is taking what we talked about last week, you know, turn the cheek. If somebody sues you, give them more, those kinds of things. And he's saying, instead, love your enemy. He is taking it and ratcheting up a notch. He's trying to get us to say, hey, we need to pause to figure out how this is possible. And I wanted us for a moment to kind of do a deep dive, maybe understand a little bit about what's going on here, because when we talk about perfection, there's a couple of things that can maybe go through our mind. There's actual physical perfection where everything is right, everything is perfect, there isn't a problem. We think of it in a utopian sense. Or there's the concept of perfection being the scenario, the environment around us, you know, our lives in general are perfect. And what we want to do is try and understand a little bit better what Jesus is calling us to when he says, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Because what we immediately turn to is, how can I be perfect like God is perfect? Everything God does is perfect. Every thought God has is perfect. Every action God takes is perfect. How can I get there? Is that what Jesus is really calling us to? And I want us to clear that up. And in order to do that, we're going to turn to somebody who is a superhero in the faith to me. It's a guy named John Wesley. John Wesley was he and his brother started the Methodist movement back in the day, and we are a Methodist church, and so Wesley is core to our understanding of how we recognize grace and some of the things that we believe. Not saying that Wesley is up there near Jesus, because he's not even close, but he has something to teach us about Christian perfection, because here's the deal. That was one of the core tenets of the Methodist movement. Actually, the ideas for Christian perfection that make the most sense to me, and hopefully will make the most sense to us at the end of this, come from John Wesley. He wrote a whole sermon. It was sermon number 40, very eloquently named, which was on Christian perfection. So it takes a look at this concept, because Wesley believed that perfection was attainable. Wesley believed that we could be perfect as Jesus is perfect, be perfect as our Father is perfect. And so it's going to be interesting for us, because we're going to take a journey with Wesley to kind of figure out how he means perfection. Because if we think of God's perfection and we think we need to be like that, you know, beyond reproach, unable to fall or fail, then we're not taking seriously what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, I know you're human, but I also know that you are capable of so much more than you believe yourself capable to. So let's take a look. Here's what Wesley says in sermon number 40. Christian perfection, therefore, does not imply, as some seem to have imagined. So he has some critics around Christian perfection. So it doesn't imply an exemption either from ignorance or mistake or infirmities or temptations. Christian perfection isn't the ability to just move beyond all of those things. We'll still have imperfections. We'll still have mistakes. We'll still be ignorant. We'll still have infirmities. We'll still have temptations. And we label those imperfections, and I said imperfections, but what that truly is that's the human condition. So we all struggle with those things, and that's not what Jesus is perfecting. What we see here is that is a physical concept of perfection. What Jesus is offering is more spiritual. What Jesus is calling us to is more spiritual. Indeed, it is only another term for holiness. They are two names for the same thing. Here's what we need to catch this. This is something we need to take hold of. Holiness and perfection in Wesley's understanding are the same thing. So when we think about Christian perfection, we are thinking about holiness. Now, if I said, be holy as your Father in heaven is holy, that makes it a little bit easier for us to embrace, for us to understand, maybe for us to digest a little bit. Wesley continues, thus everyone that is perfect is holy. And everyone that is holy is, in the scriptural sense, perfect. Yet we may lastly observe that neither in this respect is there any absolute perfection on earth. So what he's saying is there is no absolute perfection that happens on earth. So there is never a point that you will be absolutely perfect, unable. So physically, you won't age and you'll be perfect. That's what he's talking about, that physical sense. There is no absolute perfection. And he continues, there is no perfection of degrees, as it is termed, none which does not admit of a continual increase. Now, Wesley was in the 1600s, and I know this can be hard for us to understand, but I want you to catch this. What he's saying is, you don't get to a point and you're like, I'm perfect, I'm done. What he's saying is, every time you attain perfection, it's not a once and done state. It's a state of continued growth. You're continuing to grow. You're continuing to seek. You're continuing to try to be more and more like God. Not that you've attained perfection and everything is done, but that there is always going to still be more that you can do. You're holy, but you can always be holier, and God is holiest. So we're on this journey, this growth in grace to be more like Jesus. Wesley continues, so that how much soever any man hath attained, or is in how high a degree soever, he is perfect. I'm going to read that again because I did a bad job. So that how much soever any man hath attained, or in how high a degree soever he is perfect, he hath still need to grow in grace and daily to advance in the knowledge and love of God his Savior. Again, the important, well, really, we can stop and say, Wesley said what? Mostly because, again, it's 1600s. When he wrote this, it can be difficult for us to understand. Basically, Wesley is saying that, number one, he's saying this, perfection and holiness are the same thing. Perfection and holiness are those interchangeable terms, and we're talking about Christian perfection and holiness. And here we have to get into that, is that he says, although we're on this journey toward being made perfect, we never get to a finish line until we are in the presence of Jesus. And maybe then we keep growing in grace, but we get to be more and more like Jesus. And as we grow in grace, as we become more like Jesus, we are becoming more perfected. And in the process, we are perfect in Christ. Now, that can be hard for us to stomach, because we can look at that and we can say, well, how can I be perfect? I mean, I know all the things I do wrong. I know all the ways that I do things that are against what Jesus said, and I know all the things that I struggle with. And maybe you're in that same place, and you want to understand how we can work through this, how we can embrace this concept of holiness, that we can be made more holy, and that in the process, God is perfecting us. And here's what, this is Wesley still tying in these two thoughts in the end of his, is we need to grow in grace, and we need to have love. And so here's where he pulls those. This is from 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. Amen. So here's the deal. We need to grow in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And that includes our grace. We need to embrace that and allow God to do a thing, a work, a process in us. And we need to grow in knowledge. So we need to spend some time in the presence of Christ, trying to be more like Christ, not just wishful thinking, hoping that God will do something different, but instead embracing the possibility that Christ will change us, that Christ will make us new, that Christ will make us different, as we are striving and struggling to be made different, so that we allow God to do that work in us. And he also ties in from the letter that Paul wrote to the church in Philippi. We call it the Epistle of the Philippians, or the letter to the Philippians. It says this, and this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in the knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Paul is trying to help us to understand growing in grace and what it requires. And Wesley talks about that, is that growing in grace, growing in love, in depth, And seeking after that is reaching toward perfection. It's seeking after, allowing God to move within us and change us. And you might sit out there and you think, man, what you're saying is impossible. What you're saying is just not possible. I know me too well. And I know that there are those of us that are saying that, because I have said it myself. Before I really took the step into ministry, I really was hard on myself, thinking, you know, there's just no way. I am just so broken, so messed up. I am useless to God. And God says, That is not the case. And here's why. We already looked at it, but it's the same principle. Jesus looked at them. Jesus looks at us and says this, with man, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. God is the one that is trying to do the work in us. We're not trying to take God's power and holiness on ourselves and cram ourselves into his perfection. Really, what we need to do is we need to move out of God's way. We need to allow God to do the work in us that he's already striving for. That God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, is already moving to change us, to grow us, and to make us more like him. And yet we want to hold on to some of the bits of brokenness and hold on to the things that we enjoy, that we know that God doesn't like that, but we're going to do it anyway because we like that. And God's saying, I promise you, it will be so much better if you just let go. Let go and let me help you to be the person that I know you can be. And we still have a hard time with this. And so really, truly, this is something we need to understand. If God is perfecting us, how can we believe that we can't be perfect? How can we believe that it's impossible? And again, by perfecting us, God is making us holy. God is setting us apart for his work. God is using us to be a catalyst for change in the world. God is leveraging our presence by the power of his Spirit to do a profound work in the world. And here's what the truth of the matter is it's a process. It doesn't happen all at once. I remember when I first became Christian, for like 3 days, I really believed this. I thought all of the sin and all of my brokenness was just gone. It was going to be great. Like, I became Christian and I was like, hey, I'm not going to do bad things anymore. I'm going to live by what Jesus said because I have the Holy Spirit. It's all good. Now, my habits and my brokenness and the things that I had liked before kind of kept creeping back in. And I look at that. And I struggled with that because I couldn't figure out, why am I not the way that Jesus wants me? Why am I having to struggle through this? And what I found is that the process of growing in grace refines and purifies us in a way that we don't get any other way. We're not able, I mean, God knew that I had rough edges and was working to polish those rough edges off. Some of those rough edges I didn't even know were a problem. And yet God comes and works to perfect me from the inside out, transforming me and freeing me from that. And so here is what Wesley believed freedom from sin was all about. This is what he says happens when we are perfected in Jesus. We are freed from outward sin. Now, that would be pretty cool. If I could just behave the way that Jesus wants me to, that we would be freed from outward sin. But here's the real kicker. We would be freed from inward sin. This is our heart, our mind, when we think evil thoughts or we have hatred or wickedness in our lives. This would free us from that. So it's not just our actions. It's our motivations, it's our desires, it's all of that. And what Wesley is saying, and I believe truly what Jesus is saying through Wesley is, you can be perfect the way that I have asked you to be because I am sending my Holy Spirit to you. And when I say perfect, again, it is not physically perfect. Because I still don't have hair on my head, and I would really hope that that would recover. But that's not happening. So it's not physically perfect. It is instead holiness, spiritual perfection, that Christ is after us to transform us from the inside out. So maybe you're sitting out there and you're thinking, man, I am far from holy. I am far from where God wants me to be. And that's okay because you're on the journey. Maybe you're sitting out there and you're thinking, I am closer than that guy or somebody else. And that's okay because you're on the journey too. Or maybe you're sitting out there and you're like, I've attained. I've attained what you're talking about. And that's okay, because you're on the journey too, because like Wesley said, you don't ever reach the finish line. You just keep desiring to grow in that relationship. And so good for you to be there, but we still have work to do. And again, we just have to get out of God's way, letting God transform us from the inside out. And how do we do that? What does that look like for us? As United Methodists, for those of us that call the United Methodist Church home, whatever, United Methodists, we have these five things that we hold on to in the Missouri Conference, and that is this: prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. Through our prayers, we are communicating, building, deepening, and growing our relationship with God to allow the Holy Spirit to find those rough edges and make us more like Jesus. We practice the presence of God, and we practice being present with others. Now, this is a great time, a great conversation piece, because I know that my son is currently in town visiting, and we sat last night for like 10 minutes, and he was on his phone, and I was on the tablet, and we didn't have a conversation. We weren't present with each other. We were just in the same room. And what Jesus, what we desire from this is our presence with one another so that we can make a difference on behalf of Jesus Christ. Our gifts, the way that we give, the way that we share what God has given to us with others so that we can make a difference for Jesus Christ. Our service, so that we can go into the world and build up people, other people, so that they can experience wholeness and life the way that Jesus wants them to. That's our service. And our witness, our ability and our desire to share the good news of what Jesus has done in our lives and what we can do in the lives of others. I know that we have so much that is possible to hear about and to contemplate about, and I know that this can be a hard concept, but Christian perfection, being holy, is possible. Jesus calls us to do this together. Jesus doesn't want us to do it all by ourselves, so we come as a community to strengthen our faith, to deepen our relationship with our Father, to grow in grace and to love God and to love our neighbor so that we can be made perfect. And one of the things that I pray for us every week is by the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, may we all be made perfect in Christ. This is in my devotional. This is the thing that I use to try and remind myself that I want to be perfect, but it's not just about me, it's about us. We are on this journey toward perfection, and we can together make it a step at a time to grow in grace and be more and more like Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Holy One, we give you thanks for the gift of Jesus Christ and for the hope that we have in you, the promise that we have of perfection, not of physical perfection while we're here, but instead of holiness, of a spiritual perfection where you make us more and more like you by our desires, by our passions, by our love. We are made more and more into the image of Jesus Christ so that we can go out into the world and share that with everyone we encounter. Father, help us by the presence of your Holy Spirit to be transformed. Help us to get out of your way and to allow you to do a powerful work within us, that others will take note of the power and the presence of Jesus within us so that we can share that love and grace with everyone we come in contact with. We pray this in the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and all of us agreed and said, Amen.